Good morning, everyone. I just hit start, begin. What else can we do? I recall something that Jesus said, very interesting. He's talking about something that we have a great trouble, difficulty with, and he says, what can I do? I know this is difficult for you, but I have no choice but to just keep saying this, to keep saying it. I have no choice but to keep saying this. And we have no choice but to continue to keep hearing this, keep hearing it. We have no choice, actually. So it's you know, you might say it's like breathing. If we have to breathe right here, well, we have to hear spiritual truth here. No choice. And those who seem to be delinquent in the classes, they don't come to class and they're delinquent, well, they're just postponing it, and they'll get a return ticket until they finally, that, you know, spend time hearing the truth, getting familiar with the truth until it sinks in. The truth is quite different than we assume it to be, and that quite different than what we've been taught it to be in the mainstream teachings of the world. You might sum it up saying, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Right, I am not a body, I am free. All politics is spiritual politics, actually. All politics is spiritual politics. And what this is, this world, these bodies, they're dream figures. It's a dream. It's a spiritual dream. It's a dream designed to camouflage, to distract attention away from the non-causality of spiritual arrogance, okay? Spirit is animating these bodies, and these bodies are just inert stick figures, actually. Spirit is animating them. Even to the point in the dream, I had a dream last night that was quite illustrative of this, is something was trying to get in the door, and I was like behind the door. I was trying to prevent them from coming in. There was a big struggle, and then finally they came in the door. I said, oh my gosh, I got to get rid of them. And so I pushed them into this sunken swimming pool, this really deep swimming pool with tile. There's like no way to get out. And then I saw some ladders there that go up the side, and I grabbed the ladders, and I was getting rid of them so this guy could not climb out of the pool. And then I saw another set of ladders. And I looked at it, and I looked down at the pool, and I saw how deep it was, and I saw how desperate the entrapment was. There's no way to get out, and I just had mercy. I just said, wow, yeah, forget it. I'm not going to pull those other ladders up. If they want to come up, they can come up out of the pool. And then later, the person I pushed into the pool came up and saw me at a computer work, and they said, oh, you're working on this. That's good. I said, this is an odd dream. And what I realized was that the quote-unquote person that was trying to get into the room was really spirit. And why was I, this human person, fighting against him? Then why did I push him in the pool? What kind of power do I have to push spirit into the pool? And I realized all of this was a dream by spirit. This me in the dream was actually just a dream figure that spirit was dreaming all this to make it seem like spirit didn't have the power, was pushed into a pool, was trapped, and then was shown mercy to get out of the pool. And all of this, spirit was animating the whole thing, 100%. I just said, wow. In other words, spirit says, hey, I want to be pushed into this pool like I'm trapped. And so it has this body dream figure act like it's pushing in the pool, but actually it's spirit that is 100% animating, like a puppet, animating all these bodies, 100%. So spirit like pushed itself into the pool, and then spirit showed mercy on itself by allowing us to have a ladder to get out of the pool. And so spirit's saying, no, I don't want to stay trapped here forever. I want to get out of this pool. And then spirit was able to get out of the pool, pretending that this body was showing mercy to it. Bodies are neutral, they're inert, they're like a puppet. And this is this is a fact that this is all a dream of spirit. Design and why is spirit dreaming all this is what we've gotten into, and laid it very clear what's going on here. It's camouflage. It is camouflage for spiritual arrogance. And ultimately, it derives from spirit trying to change reality and be greater than God. Spirit realized the only way it could try to do this was to imagine that reality was imperfect. Okay, and then feel a conflict with God, because God says reality is perfect. And then spirit saying, okay, let's make a deal. I'll give up saying that reality is imperfect if you give up saying it's perfect. If you give up that position, give up your position. And we'll and then to somehow make this deal work, we said, okay, look, we'll have a competition. We'll say neither side is right for now. Okay, so it wasn't a complete giving up of positions. It's saying, let us both suspend our positions and put the issue up to a contest. And whoever wins the contest, that will prove the truth of the situation. And so we have invented this dream-like contest with God, actually. And we're trying to perfect form, perfect bodies. In this dream, we're having a dream of a contest, actually, with God. And we believe that we'll be able to win this contest. And in winning it, Spirit will then have proven that it is, that God is imperfect, and that Spirit is has perfected itself, and it's greater now than God. And so it sounds like, wow, you know, it's odd, but isn't this whole world, all bodies, all this stuff, isn't it extremely odd? Isn't this whole thing extremely odd? Well, this explanation actually fits and fits. Why is it so odd? Why is this whole situation so strange? So this deal, this competition, this deal, say, okay, we have this difference. Spirit says, I see you as imperfect, you see yourself as perfect. Let's instead of being conflicted with this, let's decide to put the conflict aside, and we say it's undecided. It's to be determined. And we're going to determine it by a contest, so to speak, and we'll see who can prove their point properly within this contest. But we're the ones who actually invented this deal, this contest. God has nothing to do with any of this. God is not involved in any contest. God is not entered into any deal. We're just imagining this as a way to play out our desire to be greater than God. We said, we'll do it by a contest, and so this contest is called space, time, process, and form. Time, space, process, and form. Time, space, process, and form. It's a dream, and just like in a dream, everything that's happening in a dream is happening through the desire of the dreamer. There is nothing autonomous happening in a dream whatsoever. nothing. The same way this world, there is nothing autonomous happening in this world, which is, I say, all politics is spiritual politics, 100%. Meaning there's nothing autonomous happening in this dream whatsoever. And we might say, wow, you know, how is that possible? Well, Spirit is a big dreamer. It can dream big because it has the same creative capacity as God, except it cannot change what it is. Cannot change what it is. So it's able to dream big, and this is what it has done. It's and it's ludicrous. It is so absurd for spirit to think that it is somehow bound by determinacy. Spirit is absolutely free. Now, if you look at this universe, this is a universe of determinacy. The planets are, you know, orbiting. Everything's orbiting. Everything's spinning. Everything is locked into determinate patterns, right? The Earth is rotating on its, spinning on its axis. And as it does that, it you know, orbits the sun. And there are greater orbital patterns in the galaxy. Everything is orbiting around the, going, I guess, spinning around the center of the galaxy. And but everything is locked into these fixed patterns, process, time, space, process, and form. Okay, this is a dream. This is a dream. This is a dream of determinacy. And this is a dream in which spirit is trying to prove it's greater than God. And we have no choice but to keep hearing this and keep hearing this until we recognize this. And ultimately, you know, humans don't ultimately do anything. They're just puppets. It's spirit that has to realize it. Now, spirit may seem to realize it through people. This is what people think. But actually, this isn't so. Actually, the kind of enlightenment the world is pursuing is an actual attempt to block spirit's recognition that it's all a dream. It's attempting to block it. And spirit is trying to say, oh, I can't realize this because the humans have become enlightened. You know, and this is now, they've changed, and now they're greater than me. And it's no longer a dream. They're now in charge of all this. They've turned it into a reality instead of a dream. You know, this is the effort that the dream is trying to take. And this is what's going towards artificial intelligence, the way that humans are being manipulated by spirit, ultimately. There are some puppets manipulating other puppets, you know, but the puppeteer behind all of it is spirit, nothing other than that. And spirit is trying to raise up form, time, space, process, and form, so that it's quote-unquote enlightened. That's why spirit has called this last 500 some odd years the Age of Enlightenment. Age of Enlightenment. Scientific inquiry, Age of Enlightenment. Spirit's desperately trying to claim that humans are enlightened, or that we're going towards enlightenment. No. Real enlightenment is spiritual recognition, self-realization, recognition by spirit. This is all a dream. That's real enlightenment. It's just an acceptance of repentance, of saying, wow, this has all just been my arrogance, trying to camouflage the fact that I can't change God, that I can't make an imagined imperfection of reality stick to reality at all. We put it into this guise of this deal where we're going to compete and decide, you know, who's greater. This is all a dream. It has no effects on what we are whatsoever. It hasn't bound us at all. Dreams don't bind a dreamer. What's happening in a dream is not causative to the dreamer. Okay, it's non-causative. Arrogance is non-causative. And we're trying to camouflage that by saying, well, this is indeterminate. We haven't been able to determine whether it's causative or not. And the determination is in the future. And we're having this race, we have this contest with God. And in other words, to be determined. To be determined. We don't say it's determined or indeterminate. We say, well, it's to be determined. So we think the outcome is up in the air, and it's to be determined. And this is absolutely not true. So real enlightenment is the recognition of this. So these trance states that we pursue, or various, you know, pursuits that we seem to pursue, are, we're actually spirit trying to block its own recognition. And the activities that bodies go through, stuff. It's really spirit playing out this idea that somehow its recognition is being blocked, or potentially could be blocked, or it's to be determined whether it's blocked or not. It's to be determined whether bodies can create their own reality, and that they actually, what spirit's trying to do is trying to make lies true and make it ultimately where bodies now claim, hey, they made all of this, you know, the universe and everything, trying to get artificial intelligence to be in control of it all, be in control of it all. And then spirit will claim, you see, I won, God, you know, this is what it's trying to do. It's crazy, but this is obviously, you know, we can see it playing out. Absolutely see it playing out. And again, we have no choice but to hear this. We just have to hear it and accept it more and more. What has to hear it? An accepted spirit, not the human body, which is just a mere inert puppet, actually. But the way that spirit plays with this whole thing, it makes it seem as though humans are some sort of autonomous being, and that spirit is interacting with humans. You know, this is a dream. This is a delusion. You know, I know you hear people say, well, we're a human with a spirit, or we're a spirit with a human body. You know, this dualistic. There's no dualism at all. The body is completely neutral, inert, like a ragdoll puppet. It has no autonomous will or mind of its own whatsoever. And everything that bodies do is 100% the dreaming, the will of spirit, 100%. So it may appear that there's some interaction between body, human beings, and spirit, but this is a delusion. It's all spirit. Just like in that dream I had of, I seemed to have pushed this person into a pool. Now, it was spirit that wanted to be pushed into the pool, and so it says, body, you're going to now push me into this pool, and the body, and so it then animates the body to push it into the pool, and then spirit says, I'm going to fall into the pool, and oh, now, body, you're going to pull up to the ladder to keep me trapped here, and okay, now, body, you're going to decide not to keep me trapped here, you know, as if the body, human, it is the savior of spirit, sort of thing. So, but actually, that's what spirit wants. Spirit wants to claim that body is its savior, that the humans, the body's time, space, process, and form is saving spirit. Because in this contest, spirit believes that the winner is now the true prime creator, and the loser is annihilated in an abyss. So spirit thinks if it doesn't win this contest with God, it's going to be annihilated. So it sees bodies as its savior, saving spirit from annihilation, human bodies and their actions. But again, human bodies doing nothing of their own accord. It's all spirit is doing this. Very, very odd, but very true what's taking place. So it may seem that, you know, that humans get enlightened. And of course, that's what everybody will take it that way. All spirits will, here in this world, almost all will say, oh yeah, this is what's happened. But that's not really what's happened at all. What happens is spirit recognizes, ah, you know, this is what I've been doing. It's just all arrogance. And I don't need to use this body to save me anymore. So I can now admit that this body is nothing but my own actions, actually, here. It's nothing but spirit at play. And then the body may seem to act in a different way, but the body has never been autonomous. It's never been acting, doing anything. So the real enlightenment is this recognition, and the world, spirit, that are still arrogant will, you know, don't understand this. They don't understand what enlightenment really is at all. They have it backwards. So spirit can put a light, as it were, in the awareness of the body, and then pretend, you know, the body saying, oh wow, it's like there's a light there, you know, what is this? And so spirit may continue to go through the motions of pretending, right? Because when in Rome, do as the Romans do. This is what is going on here. But it's spirit that's putting a light there, and it's spirit that's recognizing the light. Spirit recognizing spirit, saying, oh, spirit says, oh, I recognize that light. And the spirit says, that's not coming from the body, that's coming from spirit. I put it there. Body didn't put it there. I'm recognizing it. The body doesn't need to recognize it, but it will act as if the body's recognizing it in some way. So everybody here can feel a little bit comfortable. At least that's what it seems like to me. It's like in a dream. How do you wake up from the dream? Well, the hero of the dream sees a light, you know, and says, "Hey, I'm following that light now, and I'm going into that light now and stuff." But really, it's the dreamer who's orchestrating all of this to sort of give a continuity, sense of continuity to the awakening. So spirit wants to give a sense of continuity to this awakening, so that it feels that its creativity, you know, there's not some, it feels smooth to it, which, you know, is fine, honoring its creativity. Because it's quite a shock of spirit to recognize that it's done all of this, and there's been no autonomous action in this dream whatsoever. See, it's structured the whole dream to seem as if there's all this autonomous action going on. So it can have believe that there's some contest saying, "Look, God, this autonomous action is going to determine the winner between you and I. Is it going to go for you or for me?" That kind of thing. And is it going to decide, "Yeah, I like time, space, process, and form. We vote for that." And we're going to say, "Oh, God, sorry, you're outvoted. This autonomous action decided that it likes my plan better than yours." And so it set it up to be all this so-called autonomous being, autonomous consciousness action. There isn't any such autonomous action at all taking place. This is all total self-deception. It's all spirit. It's doing everything. And again, Jesus says, "I have no choice but to keep saying this and keep saying it and keep saying it and keep saying it." So we don't have any choice but to keep listening, keep listening, keep listening. And one way to listen is to say it. One way to listen. So I'm saying it. That, and as I'm saying it, I'm hearing it and listening to it. Got on a scale yesterday and it was way too heavy. And I said, "Uh-oh." So I said, "Okay, nothing but grapefruit smoothies. Put a grapefruit juice, an orange, and a banana, and some blueberries and some raspberries, and that's it. You can leave out the berries if you want." And that's all I had yesterday. It was just grapefruit juice, grapefruit smoothies. Lost about 3.5 pounds. So I feel a little better this morning. Oh, hummingbird. I mean, just arrived their morning. Okay, they checked out this flower, and the flower didn't have nectar, so it went on to the next one. But we're in a time where the pressure, the stress is so severe. You just want to feel good about yourself in some way. So if you're eating, you know, it's the easy way. It's what most people do. Is music and eating and graphics. That's what I've been doing. Graphics, music, and eating. Those are three bad habits. Because what we need to do is keep listening to this truth of the situation. So does the body wake up? No, the body never does anything. It's spirit that recognizes that this is the truth. Now, a spirit can put a light with a body just to help other spirits recognize. So a body may seem enlightened. But again, no, it's just spirit putting a light there. That's still part of the dream, as it were, like a lighthouse. Let's say there's this puppet sitting here, and you bring a candle over and put the candle by the puppet. You know, does that mean that the puppet's enlightened? No, it doesn't mean. It means spirit put a light near the puppet. So spirit may like place this light so the body seems enlightened maybe in some way. There's light. But that's just, again, that's just part of the dream, just a mere appearance that spirit is now doing. So Jesus says, I have no choice but to keep repeating all this, but he says eventually it will sink in. Eventually you'll get it. And he's very sure about this. He says, yeah, it seeps in slowly. He says, it seems to take a while. It can be, seem to be real slow, but it does seep in. It gradually does seep in. And how different this teaching is than the teaching of the quote-unquote world. The unrepentant, arrogant spirit has its teachings that it believes in autonomy, that there's autonomous action taking place, and that this autonomous action is going to determine the winner. How deceitful is this? It's self-deceit entirely. The spirit is just engaged in deceiving itself. Not wanting to admit that its arrogance is non-causative. You know, when Spirit said, God, I see that perfection isn't perfect, it's imperfect. Well, that doesn't have any effects on perfection at all. And we believe we should be able to change reality. That, you know, we want to be greater than God. That would be greater than God because we're changing the will of God. That means we have a greater will than God. If we can change reality, it means we have a greater will than God. So this is the purpose of all of this dreaming, time, space, process, and form. Keep in mind, if God can, quote-unquote, create a universe, which God doesn't, but if God could do that, we could do it too. We have all creative power of God, same, except we cannot, we're not prime creator, we cannot change reality the way that it is. That's it. We cannot change ourselves. We cannot change what we are. We cannot change the fact that we're perfect freedom. We cannot change the nature of reality. It's impossible. We cannot do that. But that's what we're trying to do, actually. And again, God had no choice but to agree to a contest. And the outcome of this contest will then determine who's greater. And the supposed contest, what's supposed to determine this, is the supposed autonomous activity of this universe. Supposedly, there's this autonomous activity, and we claim that neither one of us knows where it came from, necessarily. But that we agreed that there would be this autonomous, God and Spirit agreed there would be this autonomous activity of time, space, process, and form that ultimately is going to determine the winner. And again, the truth is, all of this activity we are seeing is 100% coming from Spirit as like a dream. Like it's a wish fulfillment, so to say. It's a wish fulfillment. It all arising due to wish fulfillment, which is the reality, whatever we desire to experience is a wish fulfillment. We experience it. So this is the same, but it's like a dream where of autonomy, where the dream is autonomous to the dreamer. Now, I know this may sound odd. We think that enlightenment, it has to do with, you know, breathing exercises and yogic postures and being a good person. I don't know, all sorts of stuff. And hearing this is like, wait a minute. What we're hearing here is that none of this is autonomous. It's 100% a dream of Spirit, when Spirit is animating every last detail of all of it in an attempt to make it seem like it's autonomous. To solve an imaginary contest which doesn't even exist. How can you have a contest if there's only one contestant? God is not in any contest or deal at all. It's all our imagination. This is what we need to be hearing. And this is the wow. This is what we do here. We hear the truth here. And this produces a wow. So we've been flipping the script when we do have three aspects to our practices: assertions, full stop on the wow, flipping the script. Flipping the script is looking at the situation in a different way. Okay, looking at it in a different way. Hearing the truth. Now, assertions are putting that truth into a real strong, punchy sort of assertion that we can make. Yes, I already know that there is nothing autonomous to spirit. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing autonomous to spirit. Yes, I already know that in this dream, there's nothing autonomous. Yes, I already know that there's nothing autonomous happening in this dream. It's all coming from spirit. Yes, I already know that there's nothing autonomous taking place in this dream of time, space, process, and form. It is entirely the wish fulfillment of spirit. Yes, I already know there is no contest taking place whatsoever. Now, my throat is starting to get hit by this. Now, this reflects an ambivalence on the part of spirit to be saying this. So, spirit is getting the body to say this, and it's also ambivalent, so it interferes with it in terms of coughing and being unable to speak. Spirit's like saying, whoa, wait a minute, wow, let's stop here, full stop on the wow, this is too intense. So we have to honor this. Well, who's we honoring? I mean, spirit has to recognize what's going on and full stop in the wow, because the spirit has this continuity fear that says, I can't accept that it's all non-autonomous. There's nothing autonomous at all. I can say that some of it, you know, but not all of it. You know, this is the struggle that spirit has. And Jesus tells us, yes, we must recognize that all of it is non-autonomous. 100%. There's nothing in this dream that is autonomous. Not a single speck, iota, has ever been autonomous in this dream. Never. There's nothing autonomous from spirit or God. No. There's nothing appears by itself without spirit desiring it to be so. Without God, ultimately co-creation between God and spirit. But the nature of reality is it experience arises based on our wish for it to arise. And God is the perfect freedom that is all of this, so to speak. And spirit is the desire and experience, or desires for these experiences to arise. But God is all of it, all in one. But nothing is autonomous to the desire for the experiencing to arise. No autonomous experiencing whatsoever. That's why we can say nothing is ever happening to us. It's impossible that anything ever happen to us autonomously. That's why I say there's no such thing as victimization. Jesus says this over and over. There's no such situation as victimization whatsoever. How could there be? It's spirit acting out everything. The body does absolutely nothing of its own. There's nothing autonomous happening. Now, spirit, the puppeteer, has all these puppets in its hands, and it decides that in order to make it seem like there's autonomy taking place in this dream, it may have this, you know, victimization sort of thing, and people will say, oh, well, not people, but then spirit will say, oh, through the bodies. Bodies will be saying, oh my gosh, you know, this spirit couldn't have done this. This is autonomous. This is part of the autonomy of this situation here, human existence. And yet, who is speaking? Spirit is always speaking. There's no words that are ever spoken that are not spoken by spirit. There's no actions that are never ever undertaken except they're taken by spirit. There's nothing acted upon other spirit than spirit acting upon itself, actually. And claiming that this was happening is autonomous to spirit. This is all that's going on here. And you know, it's difficult. I'm having difficulty speaking because of the fear factor, continuity fear. And you might ask, well, why isn't this spoken here in this world? Because spirit's afraid to speak it. It's not like I, the person, am speaking this. That's not, no person ever speaks anything. The body never speaks of its own accord at all. It's all spirit that is speaking. So, spirit. Uh-oh. I need to calm down here. The spirit needs to calm down. See, it's getting nervous about this. So this is why we practice full stop in the wow. Okay, this is why we practice full stop in the wow. Who developed this practice? Spirit did. Spirit did. Call it the Holy Spirit. It's one and the same. Spirit has this practice of assertions, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script. And it's both assertions and flipping the script lead to the wow. Okay, it's like a triangle, sort of. And when you feel that, oh, I just can't, I better, I'm losing my voice, I can't hardly talk, that means I'm in the wow mode so strongly. I better just full stop in the wow a little bit. So again, I was saying, why don't we hear this more often in the world? Some anyone, any body saying this, it's not a body saying it, but spirit animating the vocal cords of a body speaking this, because this continuity fear, spirit's very frightened. So rarely do you hear this spoken here, which is why spirit is, you know, it's nerve is like, it's like worried, it's concerned. And my voice, the voice, not my voice, but the voice that is being projected by spirit, is, it's, you know, it backs away a little bit. It says, whoa, let me back off of this. So if I try to keep speaking this way, the voice will start right here. It gets very ticklish, and like I can't even speak. Sometimes when you're trying to speak to people, to sometimes when I try to speak, share some truth with people who don't want to hear it, my voice goes quiet and whisper, and it just disappears. I can't even talk. Can't even talk. I just have to go away because the resistance is so strong. They're so adamant that this is not true, that I am an autonomous body. I am an autonomous human being, and we are ultimately going to decide, you know, the truth. Who's the winner? We have a very important role to play. These humans, this is spirit saying this as if it's human believing this. We have a very important role to play, that we are ultimately super important to God. And of course, spirit tells us this, that it doesn't tell us that actually we're in its employ, so to speak. It's doing this to defeat God, but it says, "Yeah, you're very important to God. You ultimately are going to, you know, decide the truth. You make a, you, and the whole cosmos has this delusion." Oh, here comes the voices disappearing again. Oh, okay, full stop in the wow. This stuff is so heavy that I better be careful with this. I'm trying this. So spirit is playing out this out by having all these extraterrestrials come to this planet right now and acting out this idea that humans are super important, that humans play a pivotal role in the universe and the cosmos. This is just reinforcing the delusion of autonomy. This fierce little dream. This is how it's dreaming it right now. That humans have to evolve. In other words, their autonomy has to become greater. They have to realize their greater autonomy and their greater power. If we could see this from the standpoint of truth and spirit, it's hilarious. And so we're being told, reinforced, oh, you're so important. Humans are so special. You have a great role to play in God's creation. In fact, you have the central role. You know, you have to. This is just spirit saying this stuff to itself. Making all this up and wishing that these appearances play out this play, this theater. It's like making a movie for itself and just is watching the movie that it's literally producing through its wishing. So what do I want that movie to be like? Oh, that's what it's like. But the movie's not making itself at all. But it's a dream, it's a wish for autonomy, that there be something autonomous from spirit's wishing, which is impossible. But it acts that way, which is funny. So yeah, the spirit is like shocking itself by saying this, which is why the body seems to, you know, its functionality seems to lapse. Now, spirit may put a light with this body, so other spirits, or other aspects of spirit, spirit will say, "Look, the truth is being spoken. I'm putting the words of truth through the speaking mechanism of this body for you to hear." And other spirits can then, you know, listen, pay attention, attend to people. There's a situation in this world where if you don't have some sort of rank or authority or something like that, people automatically just don't pay any attention to what you say. This is the way it goes here. You know, you have to somehow seem to have some sort of authority, which is part of the whole dream of autonomy in the first place, right? So I don't know. Maybe spirit will place a star beside this dream figure, or, you know, something like that, a light with this dream figure. So other aspects of spirit will say, you know, okay, we can, it's okay to listen to this, spirit speaking to spirit. There's only spirit speaking to spirit. And the difference in spirit, spirit's all one, but the difference right now is that some spirits are continuing to pursue arrogance, trying to make it causative, and others are repentant and said, no, you know what, this goes nowhere. It goes nowhere. Never will go anywhere. It's just aimless, meaningless and aimless and futile. But that doesn't mean that the inherent power of spirit between those two is any different. Not at all. It doesn't mean that one has higher creativity than the other. Not at all. Nothing. It's just one is pursuing an idea, this desire of arrogance to be greater than God, and the other says, no, I don't think I don't want to pursue that anymore. But as far as functionality, there's no difference ultimately, because at all, nothing is different. No one is higher or lower. No aspects of spirit are higher and lower at all. But one is wrapped, aspects are wrapped up in this dream of a contest with God, believing there's this autonomy. So it says, well, I can't act. I have to wait till the outcome of this contest. See, so some aspects of spirit are saying, well, I can't go on to glory and other experiencing, because I have to wait. I have no choice. I haven't had an agreement with God. There's this deal. I have to wait until this autonomous activity comes up with the ultimate conclusion, and only then will I be, you know, free to, you know, I have to wait for that to happen. So this is the trouble, isn't it? here. Those who have repented, realizing they don't have to wait for anything. There's nothing to wait for. There's no contest taking place. So there's no contest. How can you have a winner? There's no autonomous action taking place whatsoever. So the whole thing is nothing is going on, really, consequential at all. So there's no need to wait for any outcome at all. There's nothing autonomous, so there can't be an outcome. It's not possible for there to be an autonomous outcome. Plus, there's no... So there can't be... Nothing's up in the air to be determined. There's nothing that is to be determined at all. Everything is still... Reality is still functioning exactly the way it's always functioned. But this is the temporary difference between the two. One says they're stuck, they're bound by an agreement with God that they're going to be bound to the outcome to be determined. This outcome be determined by this autonomous action, which will determine whether it's greater than God or it's going to be annihilated. And it has to wait for this outcome. It has to wait for it. So it can't go off on any other experiencing. This is the trouble here. This is the trouble. It's like we're stuck in a trap, that song by Elvis Presley. Stuck in a trap. 1969, Memphis, Tennessee, American Sound Studios. The Baker Street Boys playing on that. And Sue Patterson or something, and her friends, co-eds, doing the background singing. They were just brought in. They like to sing together, and someone heard them and said, come on in and do the backing vocals on this. And we're stuck in a trap. Suspicious minds. Yeah. That's when, late 60s, early 70s is when this whole play really shifted over and into this. But nothing's actually happening. Nothing's actually happening. There was a time there when music was so good that, seemingly good, that we all thought, you know, hey, things are getting better. And we sort of took our eye off the listening to spiritual truth because music was so great. And I have to say, the Memphis horns also were playing there. There's a couple guys, the Memphis horns were these incredible horn players that played on, I guess, thousands of songs and 100 top 10 hits and just 40 number one hits. The Memphis horns were actually a couple of guys, and there was three others that came in, but it's unbelievable. But a lot of musicality taking place in that Mississippi, North Alabama, Tennessee area. You know, I mean, you get Nashville in Tennessee, and then you go over to Memphis, right there in the corner of Alabama and Mississippi, and then you go down just a little bit southeast to Muscle Shoals, Alabama, where they had the Fame Studios, and then you go like Tupelo, Mississippi, is just down below Memphis, which is Elvis Presley's from, I believe, Tupelo, Mississippi, right? And that whole area, it had also had a tremendous history of gospel music. Shape note, the children were taught music. It was very important. It's very important. It's a super musical area of the world, actually. Maybe one of the most musical areas in the whole world is that area of the southern United States. And these studios in Nashville, Memphis, and Muscle Shoals, they cranked out this amazing music. And they had these players, and it was just session players. And so there was a time there where the music just, I mean, it was really quite something. And then you can add the studios in Los Angeles. I think there was Western, there was it Columbia Records, and Gold Star Studios, and there were some studios in Los Angeles that was also a hub of the entertainment. You know, the movies were coming out of there. But the real punchy, great music was coming out of that triangle in Nashville, Memphis, Muscle Shoals, triangle, actually. Russell Shoals is on the Tennessee River. Memphis is on the, basically on the Mississippi River, right there on the Mississippi River. So we, historically, we, there was something that, that spirit, like, felt that, you know, music, these human beings, if you just give them good music, that'll keep them autonomous. Easy. Oh yeah, I'm listening to really spiritual music. I feel spiritual, and spirit is saying this means that this autonomous human beings have spiritual potential. They have potential. This is showing how they can be happy and stuff. This is part of the whole dream that spirit is dreaming, and their entertainment is one of the ways that it uses to keep claiming that there's something autonomous taking place, and there's potential here, human potential here. And because in the 60s, there was much more spiritual component. There was an awakening taking place. And the music, then spirit said, well, kind of ambivalent. Let me distract myself here with all this music. You know, and that's what it did. Yeah, I mean, Elvis Presley was huge in his comeback in 69, 70, 71. He was going around touring at that time, and, you know, it was just like really, really, everybody was going crazy, especially the women were completely, they always flipped out over Elvis. You know, it's like the guys and the guys, quote unquote, there's no guys and there's no girls here, actually. It's all spirit, 100%. But the guys, you know, they thought they knew the girls, we understand one another. Until the Beatles came along, until Elvis came along, you know, and then we realized we don't understand them at all. And what in the world we thought, you know, we thought we understood it. And they're just gone completely flipped out, completely freaked out, and just in a completely different dimension, you know. It's just like, what in the world is going on? Idolization, you know. Elvis, oh my gosh. The consciousness would completely shift. And they're in a different world. And it's like, you know, Elvis is the king of their world. And you don't even live in their world. That kind of thing. But actually, Elvis is just a truck driver from Tupelo, Mississippi. I was listening to some sessions in American Sound Studio, sessions of Elvis recording, Elvis in Memphis. And outtakes, you know, they had to record, they actually have tapes of the recording sessions where all the different takes where Elvis would mess up, his voice would crack, you know, he'd sing, like, ah, crack, and he'd go, damn it. And he starts swearing and cussing and laughing and... Yeah, and you realize, you know, he's just a truck driver from Tupelo, Mississippi is all he is. But he was groomed. Someone, one of the session musicians said when he saw Elvis walk in, he said, I was just blown away. I've never seen a man so well groomed in my life and tailored and groomed. You know, everything was, well, he was like a woman, basically. Is the tailoring of the clothing and the grooming was like a woman, like a diva woman, actually. Elvis, he was like super, you know, dyed his hair, you know, put pomade on his hair. Everything was conditioned to, you know, to a surface, superficial surface. But actually with the guys he hung out, he just hung out with a good old bunch of good old boys in the South. The guys he grew up with, you know, blue collar truck drivers, really, that's what he was. So he just had this, you know, resonant voice. He was a good singer. He was a good singer, but a lot of people can copy his singing style, actually. He was the son of the South, and a lot of good old boys can sing like Elvis, actually. And you put in the reverb studio there, put in the studio with all that reverb, and the Memphis boys and the Memphis horns, and the backup singers, the co-ed backup singers, and, you know, you're going to sound pretty good. You're going to sound pretty good. But yeah, he was a pretty good singer, but just you know, ordinary guy, actually. And see, us guys, we kind of get that, you know. You say, wait a minute, you know, he's just putting this on, you know. He's just a showman. That's all he really. And this is true, but the girls, oh my gosh, you know, absolutely flipped out like they were in the presence of the king of the universe. But even the guy said when he walked in the studio, everyone took a step back and just said, whoa. Because just this whole packaging of take costume and tailoring and grooming and the manners, you know, was just like the Southern manners and everything. It was just like, it was this whole package, this image. It was this image. But keep in mind that nothing was happening. It was all Spirit doing this. Spirit is doing all of this, including the reactions of the girls to Elvis, including Elvis. All of this is Spirit producing all of this 100%. But it certainly, Elvis caused such a commotion, along with the Beatles. You know, there's a musical commotion happening. It was so strong that we kind of took our eyes off spiritual truth. Spirit gave itself an excuse. So Spirit took its eyes off spiritual truth, gave itself another excuse. It's always giving itself excuses, right? Because it's afraid of annihilation. It's afraid of losing this contest. And again, there is no contest. So that's why Jesus can come and talk to us and say, hey, there is no, he hadn't said this directly. This is what is being said through this body now. But Jesus has helped lead up to this. He can say, Jesus can say all sorts of stuff. We're just like, wow, how can he say that? You know, how can he possibly be saying that? Well, this says nothing autonomous is happening. He didn't use the word autonomous, but he's saying the same thing. Absolutely, nothing autonomous is happening. So there is some, you know, unique verbiage here. It's not like I'm in lockstep with the verbiage of A Course in Miracles or Journey Beyond Words. In terms of just direct verbiage, you know, I'm not, you know, no, this is living Spirit is saying, I'm seeing it, so I'm going to say what's most, has the most emphasis for me, the best emphasis right now, and say, yeah, nothing is autonomous. There's no autonomy taking place at all in this dream. Just as arrogance is completely non-causative. So Spirit distracted itself. One of the ways was through this music. And it's still distracting. I was listening to some of it and I said, keeps going through my head, wow, it's very distracting. I was listening to some of the song I've never heard before. The Memphis Horns just cut a song of some like pre-disco kind of funk. Sort of, it's like, wow, this stuff is amazing. How snappy and funky it is. Rhythm and blues and funk and boogie and snap and crack and popple and sizzle and just popping. I never even heard the song. I'm hardly anyone who has. It's just because on YouTube, people are just putting out everything on YouTube. Now you're able to listen to this, and you said, holy cow, that's some kind of music that they were putting out there. It's funny that one of the Memphis Horn players says, I don't even know how any of this happened. He says, it's all God's doing. I don't have anything to do with it. I look back on my life, I say, I couldn't have done any of this. I couldn't foresee it. This was all God just doing this. Well, it's almost right. It's God the Son doing it all. God the Spirit doing it all. That's right. He said, it's amazing what he said. It just happened, and how it happened. He says, I have no idea. Truly amazing. Same thing with like George Jones and a great singer who's part of that soundtrack of that time too, from Nashville, country music. The Nashville sound at that time was extraordinary too. And he looked back on his life and says, I don't know what happened. He says, I don't know how I did this. It's like my life is just like a mystery to me. I don't understand. I mean, what happened? Well, because it's Spirit singing all these songs. It's Spirit playing the horns. It's Spirit doing everything. There's no human doing anything here. Human beings don't exist, actually. They've never existed. This is a figment of Spirit's imagination. It's his desire, his wish that there's some autonomous autonomous activity taking place, rather than just mere appearance, wish-fulfilling appearance taking place. There's only wish-fulfilling appearance taking place. That's it. So oftentimes these great musicians will look back and say that. Uh-oh, sneezes, heavy sneeze coming up. See, that's that spirit trying to interfere with what's being said here. I almost passed out. The spirit trying to interfere with spirit. Which is the ambivalence of spirit. There's not a Lucifer and Christ battling. It's spirit. There's only spirit and it's ambivalence. It's spirit saying, can I drop the arrogance? Oh, it seems too dangerous. I might be annihilated. So, it's one spirit, not two. There's not a division. There's no split in spirit whatsoever. It's some aspects of spirit, you know, have been took this idea of arrogance, seeing if it could change reality. And in the letting go of that, there's an ambivalence, a continuity fear. So it seems as if there's a struggle between good and evil. There's no such struggle like that at all. There's just an ambivalence taking place, a continuity fear. So spirit is wanting to get this information out. And at the same hand, it's ambivalent, saying, well, I don't say too much, I'm kind of worried, you know. So, it will then interfere with its own expression. It will pull back from it a little bit. That's all. But these musicians will look back on their lives and say, how did this happen? I don't know. Did I do this? In other words, the so-called human aspect doesn't know how it did this. It's like I was just being used like a puppet. It was someone, they said, well, it's God. They said, well, God was just doing this through me. I didn't really have anything to do with it. Well, God is just doing, God the Spirit is just doing everything through all bodies. This is true in every case. So, with this body, the Spirit wanted to bring the truth here to this world, trying to use it to speak the truth, but spirit was ambivalent, saying, whoa, you know, the spirit, other aspects of spirit, the arrogance here doesn't like this. So the arrogance is so severe in this world, this dream of a world, spiritual arrogance is so severe here, it's very thick. If you imagine spiritual arrogance as something dark and heavy, well, this world would seem to be this ball of very dark, heavy mass of arrogance here. So coming here to speak the truth is very difficult. So spirit is like very ambivalent. So this body has seemed to suffer extremely very terrible life because spirit is ambivalent. It feels terrible that it can't speak the truth here. It has trouble. But the same hand is very frightened to do so. So it's very conflicted. It's saying, I want to speak the truth, but I don't dare because, you know, spirit is going to get so angry about that. They're going to try and, you know, run a bunch of so-called autonomous activity on this body, and then spirit says, I don't know if I would want to agree with that or not. So a struggle. This life has been an immense struggle. But you can now see why, because saying this, you can obviously say, wow, you know, that's not easy for spirit to say this. That's for sure. To say it's, you know, using a body to say this here in this world, to say this, it's very difficult and rare to get this kind of emphasis here. And it's I have to do it bit by bit, otherwise my voice will, you know, I'll get severe coughing and seem to get sick, actually. There is no human being. There's never been any human being. There's never been any human being whatsoever. There's never been any autonomous activity take place whatsoever. All is mere appearance, wish-fulfilling appearance in pure spaciousness, as it's always been. Reality, the play of reality, remains untouched by any imagined contest that's taking place, as if reality has been suspended and reality says, "Oh, I can't say that I'm real until we decide the outcome of this contest, and we don't know what the outcome is going to be." That's what we're thinking. That's what we're believing. That reality is not real. It had to suspend its reality, and it's agreed to abide by the outcome of this so-called autonomous activity. Well, actually, what's taking place is this so-called autonomous activity is a evolution towards autonomy, and the way we're dreaming it is that it's going towards greater and greater and greater autonomy, and eventually it'll achieve full autonomy. It will achieve full autonomy, and when it does that, we will have proven that we're greater than God, and then God has to abide by that outcome. So you see that this dream of humanity. And this dream plays out in other places as well, but we can talk about right here, right now, this dream of humanity. The dream is going towards this dream autonomy, so-called dream autonomy, more and more autonomous from spirit, from its so-called origin. You can't speak of an origin of this because there's nothing other than that. There is no destination. There is no evolution of this situation. There is no autonomy. So how can you speak of an origin of autonomy? There isn't any autonomy. This is just all spirit. There isn't anything else. So it's very deceptive and misleading to talk about origin or cause. It's like, because we think, oh, okay, what is the cause of this autonomy? What is the origin of this autonomy? There isn't any autonomy. Zero. So how can you say there's an origin of it? That's confusing, isn't it? And in the mood of repentance, we understand this. I just want to point it out. It's just worth pointing out. We assume some progress towards autonomy. So we say, well, what's causing this progress towards autonomy? And we think, well, nothing's causing it. Well, how can nothing be causing it? I mean, it's just autonomous already. There isn't any progress towards autonomy taking place. None. So you can't say that there's... What's the question? What's the cause? What's the cause of this progress towards autonomy is a false question. How can there be an answer to that? There isn't any progress. There's zero. You can't even talk of any progress. There's no autonomy in the dream. There's no progress taking place. There's no momentum taking place. So this is non-dual talk, what we're doing now. This is what we need to hear. We need to hear this non-dual talk. There's no duality of cause of and progress. Cause and momentum. Cause and situation. There's no situation here. There's no circumstance here. There's no momentum. There's no progress. There's no autonomy. Nothing is happening in that regard at all. So how can we talk about what's causing it? Or how can we stop causing it? We don't need to stop causing what we're not causing. Again, so this is non-dual talk, and this is what we need to get used to, plain and simple. Who's we? Humans? No, spirit. There are no humans. There are no humans. So the one that's listening to this is spirit. Now, it can be spirit pretending to be a human, listening to it, at which case spirit will get it to pretend to be all confused and throw all sorts of blockage and misunderstandings and throw questions up, like, well, how do I stop causing all this, you know? Or you can be spirit listening in the mood of repentance, where spirit will say, yeah, I just need to hear this. You know, I'm very ambivalent. I got this continuity fear. So that's the only problem I really have, is a continuity fear. I don't have any other problem. This is spirit in the mood of repentance will realize the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem. I don't have a causation problem. I don't have a circumstance problem. I don't have a situation problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. Those other imaginary problems don't exist. They're imaginary. They have no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Meaning it's just spirit. Just spirit here. There's no autonomy. There's no autonomous dynamics happening at all. There are no dynamics that are autonomous from the dream, from spirit. Time, space, process, and form. That's all a dream of autonomy, of determinism, lack of freedom. It's not separate from the dreamer. The dream is not separate from the dreamer at all. Not any part of it. So, spiritual progress? Is there any spiritual progress taking place? No. There's no spiritual progress taking place at all. Is spirit recognizing this? Is that spiritual progress? No. It's just dropping the arrogance. It's just resolving this continuity. Fear is all. Spirit's already perfect. How can you say there's spiritual progress being made? There isn't any possibility of any spiritual progress being made. God created spirit absolutely perfect, whole, complete, perfect, absolutely free. There's no issue of spirit needing to make progress in any way. Evaporating this continuity fear is a pragmatic issue. It's not spiritual progress, really. It's really just spiritual repentance. Letting go of the idea of progress, the silly notion of progress, that's not actual progress. No, it's repentance. It's important to see it this way. What can spirit improve upon? It can't improve upon itself. It can say, well, I'm improving because I'm dropping this autonomy. I'm starting to lessen the autonomy. No, there is no autonomy. Well, I'm cutting the momentum of the autonomy. There's no momentum. Spirit is micromanaging, micro-producing every aspect of this dream. And Jesus says, even all of this is just, this whole universe is only just a fraction of a drop of the creativity of spirit. As much as it seems, you know, this universe seems to be so vast, and but it says just a tiny fraction of a drop in an ocean of spiritual creativity, actually. That's pretty amazing. And he says, you cannot understand that. Don't even try. But it's worth saying. I need to say that so you realize this is so. But we are spirit is micromanaging the whole dream. It has to. There's nothing, it can never be anything autonomous to spirit. It's impossible. So, those of you who are listening to this, of course, your spirit, and you realize that this is somewhat difficult. It's challenging. It challenges our continuity fear. And you realize how different this is than normal spiritual talk, right? You say, hey, wait a minute, this is quite different. Then you say, wow. Now I'm starting to see, you know, why I've been in this ridiculous, you know, a lot of spiritual aspiration is all just part of this, you know, delusion. Spirit's still trying to deceive itself. And then you might say, no wonder why it's been difficult to get to this. I mean, this is just a whole different way of looking at it entirely, right? We've assumed some autonomy or progress towards autonomy. We've assumed progress towards autonomy. We have to assume that to believe there could be a contest at all. So in order to keep our arrogance, to believe that our arrogance is causative and we can change God, we have to believe in this contest, and we have to believe that there's progress towards autonomy. We have to believe all that. Otherwise, the whole house of cards would say, that's ridiculous. There's nothing. There's no causation taking. Trying to change reality is non-causative. It can't change reality. And then we would have to just realize this is futile. It's aimless. So that's why we've been so stuck on the belief, at least, that there's some progress towards autonomy, and then building an entire belief system around this, that there's at least some progress towards autonomy. And what Jesus tells us, what truth tells us, is there's never been any progress towards autonomy at all, not even the first step. In fact, autonomy is impossible. Not only is the autonomy possible, we cannot even make the slightest step in progressing towards it at all. So that just, you know, collapses the whole belief systems and religions and belief systems and whatever, you know, is involved in this belief system. There's lots of defenses within that, defending the notion of, you know, basing their premise on at least, well, there's some progress towards autonomy, and we build different aspects of our defenses based on different ways of looking at that progress. So some say, well, we've already arrived at autonomy. Some are saying, no, we're progressing towards it. Some saying we're almost there. Some saying, well, we've got a long ways to go. It's all the same ball of wax, actually. And so when you hear the truth, say there's not the slightest speck of progress towards autonomy whatsoever. It's never happened. That then is a different belief system, isn't it? I mean, that you just realize, wow, we're talking about exchanging belief systems here. That's what we're talking about. This is bigger than what we're used to dealing with, right? This is something of a different order, really. It's different. Whether you call it bigger or smaller, or whatever you call it, it's different, that we're not used to it. We're not used to it. So it shakes our tree, and this is the wowness of it. The wildness and the continuity fear starts, you know, kicking in. It's like, if you're trying to hear it, you might say, I just can't listen to this. You know, there's resistance. Or if I'm trying to say this, I say, my voice is going again. It's drying up. My voice. Wow. Yeah. And the good thing about this setup with this microphone, I can speak real softly. So I don't feel like I'm speaking real loud to the world. Because it's frightening. I can't say this to people. It's just, I meet in the street. Hey, how you doing? Do you realize that there's absolutely nothing autonomous happening? All this is all just a wish fulfillment of spirit. There's no such thing as human beings. There never has been. There's no such thing as a universe. There never has been. There's no such thing as a world. There never has been. See, in terms of autonomy, right? There's a dream. There's an appearance we call a world. There's an appearance we call a universe. But it's all.